Normally, well, let me start with a different point. I was surprised to see that basically none of the presentations given here at an open access conference have been made available. So what I would like to see is just typing in a few keywords from that particular talk and find it on Google. So mine would be Wikis and CoASP. No other wiki papers here. Oh, you're on Google Scholar, sorry. By the way, the whole talk here is meant to be interactive. I will do several things that you probably not see in conferences very often. Most of this is on purpose, some probably not. And if there is anything you might wish to comment on, please do. Something that is really lacking in scientific communication is interaction. And I'm trying to present some of this. So the first result here is actually my talk. It's not my talk, but it's the blog post announcing it from some days ago, shortly before I went on the train. And I show it for three reasons. The first one is I already mentioned it, that the talks should be made available in an open access era or open access environment. And I'm not talking about open access only to the final published version of science or science outputs, because simply I don't believe in final published or in final science. Science is a process. And I would like to see publishers engaging more in publishing the process. And the process has many different steps to it, including conferences. The second reason I want to present this blog post is because yesterday I was making a comment on microfinancing and mentioning Flutter, which nobody seemed to know. And what it does is basically it gives you an option to fund the one who runs this blog post by clicking on that button if you are part of that Flutter scheme. And if you're interested in that, we can talk about this in the microfinance in the breakout session. The third reason for showing this blog post is because it actually links to my talk. And I can start from there. We are now in a wiki environment. And the first remark I want to make is the same as we had in this morning. These slides are mainly there for archiving. So the best way to read them is actually take your laptop, go to that page, and follow me. If you don't want to do this, you will get the overall picture, but you will miss some details. I'll just quote here John Wilbanks, who most of you might probably know, who wrote in a blog post about a year ago, "Science is already a wiki, if you look at it in a certain way. It's just a highly inefficient one. The incremental edits are made in papers instead of wiki space, and significant effort is expended to recapitulate existing knowledge in a paper in order to support the 1 to 3 new assertions made." And yeah, I have illustrations for what he has in mind. So all these slides that you're going to see, they're generated on the fly because they're HTML pages on the web. Some of them might not load, we don't know. So what I mean by inefficient, or what I think he meant by inefficient wiki, is partly things like that. You have many different publications here. 2,160 are found in Google Scholar who have a sentence, "Magnetic resonance imaging is a usually powerful technique," or something like this. But I was wondering, well, if we would combine the explanatory power of those 2,600 papers describing the technique, and there are other ways to introduce it, you don't have to use that exact phrase. If you could combine this power into one page, that's more or less the wiki approach. We would invite everybody who wants to write an introduction about that methodology, come to this article, write what you want into this article. If it's more specialized, then go to a more specialized article. And if it's relevant for something else, then go and add it to that other article as well. And this talk will be about platforms in which you can do this. There is actually a fourth reason why I mentioned my blog post before, and this is, in principle, The kind of open access publishing platforms that I'm proposing here, you could do most of this on blogs. WordPress, Drupal, and other blog softwares, they are essentially content management systems, which could do most of the stuff that you do with your content management systems in the publishing houses. Wikis are just another kind of content management system, and they are more conducive to collaboration because each wiki has a recent changes page. I will get to this later where you see what others are working on. And it's with version control. You can link to each individual version of the article anytime. So this is what traditional publishing was about. You have a stable version. You put it into a format that nobody can change, and that's it. That's the final published version. In a wiki, each version is finally published, is linkable, but still it can be updated. So you have one link which always gives you the most recent information, and if you want to dig deeper, see how things have developed, then you can go to the history. Okay, so this was the introduction. I'll now move to a more slidey way of presenting things. By the way, this cover image here has some meaning, which I will explain in the penultimate slide. And yeah, now let's go. The background, for technical reasons, publishing was historically a separate step. So you had the whole research cycle, you have an idea, you formulate the ideas, you apply for funding, if you're lucky you get funding, and once you have the funding you start doing your experiments, once you're done you write them up, and then you publish. My point is, you can do the publishing for all of these different steps in principle. So there are people who keep their lab notebooks in public, many of them use wikis. I will show one example later on. And for what traditional publishing is about, you can also use wikis. So all of what I'm saying is on those slides, so sometimes I'm going to skip over the slides a bit more quickly. Well, I already basically said it. You can use it for basically anything in science, and examples exist. They're linked here, so if you want to follow up, just go to those pages, and this will give you details. I will put the focus of my presentation on the guided tour here, which comes up in the next line, where I will show you some wikis from within. By the way, how many of you have ever edited a wiki? Okay, that's maybe one third or so. So now we're there at the core of my talk, wikis as platforms for OA publishing. Again, details are written here below, such that most of the people in the back can't see it. So I'll concentrate on the quotes, which give you a general idea. So first, the idea is not new. At least 4 years ago, that's the oldest citation I found, but I suppose there were early ideas. Someone wrote, somewhere at the fringe of science, someone will start using wiki publishing for science publishing, 2006. A little earlier, in 1988, Jack Gollner wrote in an article about the functions of scientific publishing, and he didn't have wiki in mind. But I added kind of wiki annotation by striking out what is not relevant in a wiki world. So I'll read the quote for if it were non-wiki, so paper publishing basically. So for practical purposes, we can define publishing to include, along with page design and typesetting, the functions of editing, manufacturing, advertising, selling, warehousing, shipping, billing, collection, and other aspects of value added, and who will keep the gates, how, to what end. And you see, most of this is struck through in the wiki world. In principle, you could even struck through page design and typesetting if you insist on very coherent formatting. Another quote I would like to just throw into the debate, and I really invite comments. You don't have to sit here watching. The more controversial it is, the more helpful it may be to get the message across. Apparently, people are realizing that a much more open post-publication peer review process where anyone can take part is a lot more effective, from a recent blog post. So in a sense, what I'm proposing here with the wikis is an extension of the two-step process that Ulrich has presented into an, well, n-step process, where n might be any integer as long as we have time to deal with those things. So, and in some other points relevant for using wikis in an OA world, in principle, you can use wikis even for closed access publishing because you can manage the user rights at a very fine-grained level. So you can determine whether people have to be logged in or not, whether to see certain content or whether to edit certain content or to do all kinds of things. But in principle, wikis are OA by default. They can be set to closed access, but they are OA by default. They're known basically to everybody. At least everybody has heard that wikis exist. Everybody knows some of the major wikis. And the technology is open source and developed by hundreds and thousands of volunteers. So that's a good base to start a journal on. Some prototypes exist. Prototypes in a certain sense. So there are certain wiki journals. So journals which do their whole journal processing pipeline on a wiki. There are very few of them. Most of them are really small, and they're kind of the kind of one society, one journal type. The most notable one of these is Scholarpedia, of which I have already shown the magnetic resonance imaging article before, which is basically a review journal. It has an ISSN, it has anonymous peer review, but it's implemented on a wiki. And there is an idea floating around from the Wikipedia world, they call it Wikipedia Journal. That's their way to invite experts to participate, because for the moment there is no formal way of experts to lend their expertise to Wikipedia. Of course, there are wiki encyclopedias like Wikipedia, but their expertise doesn't play a special role. Citizendium addresses this special point. It was founded by one of the founders of Wikipedia, and he said, he likes the Wikipedia model, so that platform is still open to any subject. You can write about video games or whatever. You can write about science. And there are a few more requirements. There is a stable version released of articles once they have passed the review process. And everybody has to use their real name. On Wikipedia, everybody can pretend to be Mark Patterson or somewhere else and then write articles about anything. On Citizendium, this is not possible. Another wiki encyclopedia, which has a limited scope, somewhat similar to the EGU, is Encyclopedia of Earth. They do everything Earth science, basically, and they do it on wiki. It's one of the more successful ones because they're in close contact with the Earth science community. There are others for philosophy, and I also want to mention Knoll, which is a Google equivalent, basically something like a multi-blog platform or so. And it is already used in PLOS Currents. So it has entered the formal publishing world. Another interesting twist to a combination of wikis and journals is that some traditional journals require wiki contributions. So the RNA Biology Journal, in their guidelines for authors, demands that authors, along with the manuscript, submit the draft of a Wikipedia article on that particular RNA type. And so far, this has led to several dozens of entries, but it has also sparked people who submit articles to other journals to also submit a Wikipedia draft article with that. They cannot submit the final Wikipedia article with it, because Wikipedia does not allow original research, so that article can only be started on Wikipedia once that paper got published. That's a bit strange, but yeah, it works and it's growing. Those different prototypes that I've named, they have certain editorial policies. I've put here atmospheric chemistry and plus one on the right-hand side because this is what you're familiar with. And then those four that I mentioned on the left. That's a very detailed table. Doesn't really help if I go through it in detail now. It's there on the web. And the basic meaning is you can implement any kind of peer review or any kind of access scheme in the wiki. Here are our examples. Now we're going to the guided tour. Since about one third of you have edited a wiki before, the majority haven't. Maybe I'll just demonstrate. I'm tempted to demonstrate it, but I'm not sure how well I'm doing in time, so I'll leave it for the moment. The point I would like to make with this page is the connection between publishing and non-text or non-image content, which I find too weak in current publishing. Even online-only journals, for my taste, use too little of the capabilities of the web to publish science. And I work in imaging, so for most of the stuff that I do, videos have to be added. And I have published with a journal at Copernicus, and there, all the videos, they were just contained in one zip file. So you have to download the zip, you don't know what's in there, and then you have to open it, you will have to find the videos you described in the text, well, find the right number first, then you click on it, then you see it. In other journals, like PLOS, for instance, it was in the supplementary materials. It's just named supplementary movie one or something like this. But in any HTML page, basically, you can embed videos. And in Wikis, it also comes naturally. And here's just a demonstration. My talk is embedded here in two different formats. So you can do the same thing in different ways, also on a wiki, so if you have a certain preference. Then you can also embed pages from other wikis. So one I would like to show is the one used for lab notebooks, Open Wetware. The main page is this, and about 400 labs worldwide use this as the platform in which they publish their lab notebooks. That is, I just did an experiment where I pipetted 50 nanograms of DNA onto that solution, and my notes, I don't take them, I scribble them on paper anymore, I put them on my wiki. And here comes now the recent changes page that I have already mentioned before. Basically, what you see here is those pages that have been edited last. So at 10:10, there was this page that has been edited. So you can follow the things that people are doing. So if you are interested in certain areas, you can mark any page as being of interest to you. Like here, there's this watch link. And if I add this page to my watch link, or to my watch list, and I can go to a watch list, and then I see all the pages here. It tells me, well, this page has just been changed, and so this is a kind of different way of getting journal alerts. I have stopped using journal content alerts because they're so unusable, basically. And this would be a way to tailor it much more to the needs of the end customer. So you basically just subscribe to the articles that are of interest to you, and then this is your news feed. You can, of course, you can then follow people on the individual pages. You can embed calendars. You can go for feedback platforms, or they can embed the feeds of the literature they read here from Mendeley, for instance. So you can do many things. Basically, whatever you can do on an HTML page, you can do in a wiki, even print it if you want, or for archival purposes. There's also some, although Wikipedia doesn't allow original research, they allow some projects which have relations to original research. One of them is GeneWiki, where a robot, basically a script, harvests databases of proteins and protein structures and puts that information into Wikipedia articles about those proteins. And then humans can edit those articles, make them more human readable. Citizendium is the try where they want to get experts involved. And here you see an approved Citizendium article. These are not peer-reviewed in the sense that the peer is an expert in the closed field, but that the peer has a broad expertise in what they call here the mathematics, computers, and military work groups. So they have a degree in any of those fields. And here you see the editor. It was approved by Peter Schmidt, and then you click on his user page and you know what his qualifications are. And you can see the whole history, and there is a draft page. So this green approved one is the stable version, what you would print as a publisher. And then there is a draft page, which is similar to the second stage in Ulrich's kind of publication. And you have a talk page, which is similar to the discussion phase. It's all on one platform. Okay, and Scholarpedia has some more interesting things. I have embedded some details of their review process into the PDF version of my talk, which is embedded in the starting page. And you can embed all other kinds of stuff, including Twitter messages on open access or peer review or magnetic resonance or what have you. And that's real time. If somebody has tweeted recently from here, then it should show up. Now I'm trying to get back to my presentation. Obstacles. There are very few obstacles from the technical point of view. So basically, whatever you want to do on HTML, or you can do on HTML or HTML5 when it comes, you can do on a wiki. The most obstacles are social, of the kind that have plagued the uptake of open access or online publishing years before. So scholars are used to type their manuscripts in word processors, but even in wikis, you can type as in Word. There are interfaces which allow that. And recognition problems. If you say, well, I wrote my article on the wiki, and people say, what? So what's the relation to CV promotion, tenure, grants, and so on? There are alternatives. You can do collaborative editing in other environments. For instance, Etherpad. You can do it on blogs. Like WordPress or Drupal. You can do it in Google Docs and some others. And there are converters. So for instance, if you have an open office document, you can upload it via a special converter, and then it will show up as a wiki page. The outlook is more or less what I wanted to have here, and it relates to the funding models. For instance, if you have a dedicated page for every topic, let's say magnetic resonance, or let's say open access publishing, or let's say something more specific, you could have, like the draft page and the talk page, you could have a jobs page where people post the jobs ads relevant to this topic, or an events page which announces events relevant to this topic. It's really targeted advertising. You don't mass spam people. You inform only those who are subscribed to those particular pages. So if I'm not interested in that particular topic, I won't get those messages. But if I am, then I will. And then you can link it to communities and others. And you can also, related articles, you can do semantic enhancement of this content in a way that standalone articles that the John Wilbanks quote from the initial slide referred to do not allow. They simply stand on their own. But in a wiki, everything is linked. And yeah, I've explored the details of this scheme here in much more detail for you. At the moment, the important thing is just to note what you currently do as science publishers is this. What you could do in my scheme is all the rest, and I've left out some more. And I would like to discuss what you think about extending the scheme. And now we're at the summary page. To take home, wikis provide the opportunity to structure digitally published items, published in the sense of being available on the net, more contextually than standalone articles. And wikis are compatible with any mode of peer review tested so far, and in brackets, with any mode of or business model. They can be integrated with every step of the research cycle so as to highlight research as a process and to improve also reproducibility that several speakers have already referred to. Yeah. And here are my notes for the discussion phase. Some of the questions I have anticipated, some not, so I'll see.
Okay. Thank you very much, Daniel. So, questions?
Just want to pick one of the last things you said. I entirely agree that wikis, in principle, being a platform, are compatible with any kind of business model we want to glue on top of them. There is one exception to that, that is exactly the pay to publish one article kind of thing that this audience might be interested in. Indeed, if you face a single scientist who has to give a single contribution to a single wiki, to the fact that he might have to pay to write that contribution on that wiki, that will not work. So if you take the basic vanilla APC model of open access and you try to migrate to this platform, since, I repeat, this looks far too much like the free thing, I doubt that the idea scales.
Yeah, APC is not for this model, probably, yeah. But as your survey showed, APC is just 50%, and there are other models. And here, the costs are much lower. So there are about a dozen wiki software platforms which are available for free on the net, and they're tested on millions and billions of users. And the most popular one is MediaWiki, which also those wikis use. And so you can get the operating costs down, well, at least significantly.
But I would just keep up. I think also really that this, and I'm totally not a wiki user, so I haven't used it at all, but I think that it will probably do much of the future work indeed. But I think there is a good way to connect it for real open access publishers right now, simply as this add-on that you have, right? So to merge, my idea would be really to still generate for the time being the PDFs around which things circulate, because people don't, in our community, which is not so small, they don't read HTML. They download the PDF, and then they either print it or they read it on their computer. And I think that will stay like that for a few years, at least as the key thing. And this you can also market and produce, and then on the side migrate into this wiki environment, and there will be other things opening up. So I think there is a link to the future here, and I think also in terms of scientific discussion, it's important to have a few fixed points like a snapshot. The PDF is like a picture in between to which you then, I mean, PDF is just now a synonym for other things, but you need these snapshots that you can refer to reliably and easily. And I think there is maybe a link from the current open access publishing to this wiki future that I also don't understand yet. But
okay, there are several things that rang a bell with me here. First thing is the format in which a content is published. And I very much like the point that Rob was making. They publish their stuff in ASCII, basically, what LaTeX is. And if the fashion changes from PDF to something else, then that's easy for them to adapt. They just need a different converter. And the same would basically be true for Wiki, though, the preferred format would probably be XML or something. So we just need an XML to Wiki converter. Some exist already at the basic level. And then if your content is published at XML, it can be even automatically included in some Wiki format. And I would actually encourage publishers to provide XML. Not everybody does it. And others to collaborate on tools like XML to Wiki converters. The second point I wanted to make, I have now lost. So sorry for that.
Any other points? Yes?
Okay, yeah. The second point came back. You can already print basically any Wiki page, and there are even certain plugins that make it nicely. Then it looks as if it were typeset in LaTeX or whatever. So it is compatible to the current model, but it is editable. In one of the quotes that I showed, and there was someone saying, Philip Bourne from PLOS Computational Biology said, I want publishers to publish my workflows, and someone else said, I want the web, but editable. That's the key thing in science, because knowledge is never never final. And wikis are our first attempt at allowing this. There will probably be later attempts more sophisticated. Okay, your question?
I was wondering about the cumulative nature of knowledge. Wikis obviously are ideal to accumulate knowledge and to structure that and present it in a coherent way, but you do lose a little bit the individual effort of a given, you know, a scholar, a researcher publishing something in a traditional mode. That would be an article, and you might have several researchers as author for a single article, but it would be very easy to recognize their contribution to science. And in a wiki, that becomes a little bit more difficult. And I was wondering if that isn't one of the core values, prestige, that is lost in this transferal to a wiki environment, and whether that wouldn't be a problem.
Well, I don't think it is a problem. I certainly think it is relevant. There are various people who, well, I didn't find an example right now, but one way to do this is people list the articles they've worked on their user pages, and they can do it in very sophisticated ways. And there are also already automated tools being developed. So there's one platform, WikiGenes, which I've linked from some of the pages. I will here, WikiGenes, where they pride themselves in being a wiki for the life sciences where authorship matters. So in principle, you have wiki articles harvested from PubMed and put into wiki format. And then if humans edit these wiki pages, then they each edit they make can be rated by other people on the wiki, and after time you develop some reputation. And that's similar to how we develop reputation system in classical publishing, just that we have way more data, because people would tend to have more wiki edits than they have papers right now, and it's all transparent.
Okay, one last one.
Take you always on the last thing you said. It's not like developing a reputation, I mean, making the smart or the good added to the tweaky, is not developing a reputation like in the normal system. It's like saying the right thing at a conference and at a workshop. It's a different kind of way of developing your reputation.
If you're sure. But one of the points I made is integrating wikis or online activities with any aspect of the scientific cycle. So if I made my point during a conference or workshop, then it might also be well on the wiki, especially if I attend remotely, which was not possible here, unfortunately, but which will be possible in the future more often. And then people might simply attend by typing things into a wiki page while I'm giving my talk, and that would be their way of commenting.
Okay, well, I think we probably need to end it there. I really enjoyed all three presentations. I think what it does is it really makes you begin to think about what precisely are the functions that journals and other forms of scholarly communication provide. And with all these new platforms and we've heard about different ways in which technology can be used to vary the way we carry out these processes, it really makes you begin to sort of think about how we can reinvent this whole process and improve it. So I'd just like to end by thanking all three speakers for a really good session. Thank you.